Namaste and welcome to Nepal Conversations. In this podcast series, we will talk to scholars and researchers about the interesting work on various aspects of Nepali society. We ask them to reflect on old and new problems, challenges, and possibilities confronting Nepal. The theme for Nepal Conversations' first season is disasters. We will present a series of conversations on the topic of disasters and what it means for Nepali society. This series is supported by Levy Hume Trust.
For this episode of Nepal Conversation, we are pleased to welcome Dr. Jeevan Baniya, who is an assistant director at Social Science Baha, a research institute based in Nepal. He has a Ph.D. in political science from the University of Oslo, Norway. He also serves as a faculty member in the Department of International Relations and Diplomacy, Tribhuvan University, Nepal. His academic interests include disaster, governance, labor and migration, public policies, state-society relations, democracy and development, among others. He's a team member in two disaster-related collaborative projects. First, expertise, labor and mobility in Nepal's post-conflict, post-earthquake reconstruction. And second, after the earth's violent sway, the tangible and intangible legacies of a natural disaster. His research on Majhi community in Sindupalchowk district and the effects of 2015 Nepal earthquake is published as a book chapter in a recently published edited volume, Epicentre To Aftermath, Rebuilding and Remembering in the Wake of Nepal's Earthquake. He has also co-authored numerous articles and working papers focusing on recovery and reconstruction post-2015 Gorkha Earthquake.
Welcome to Nepal Conversations, Jeevanji, and thank you very much for joining us today. You have done extensive research that focuses on Nepal earthquakes and its sociocultural aspects of disasters. Could you tell us why do we need to know about disasters from a sociocultural perspective, especially in the context of Nepal?
Thank you, Majhi, and thank you, Nimeshji, for having me in the conversation. In a couple of my previous research, I've tried to focus on the reconstruction process and trying to understand what shapes this sense of safety, resilience, and sense of ownership in the recovery and reconstruction process. And findings from those studies suggest that not only this physical infrastructure, but sense of this risk and safety can also be shaped by people's relationship with other social cultural norms and values. They do have emotional attachment to the society, to the land that they live in, the social and family space that they share with others, which was very much reflected in my study in called Majhika in Sindupalchowk, and another research area in Kartike Bazar in Sindupalchowk. So what I mean by that is that, some of the people who are reconstructing their house were not feeling comfortable with the kind of house that they were building because they were not able to perform their rituals and they were not able to commemorate their ancestors. It was also revealed that some of these affected families had even stopped doing these activities while others were trying to find some other ways to perform these activities. You know, in the case of Majhis, they needed houses made up of muds and ouds. And they also needed certain space within that structure to keep their deities, which was not happening while they started building houses with concrete, cements and things like that. So they were expressing this dissatisfaction while I was talking to them. And I think these issues are very much also reflected in the resettlement and relocation processes that is underway in some of these earthquake-affected areas, where they don't want to be relocated from their ancestor lands. Some of them do not want to share their houses with the strangers. Rather, they would prefer living with the people that they know for a long time. Maybe in some of the cases, they do want to share their houses and spaces with the families belonging to similar ethnic and caste groups, or in some cases, even with the families who belong to similar lineages. So they were reluctant to be resettled in new places with new new communities in some of these areas. However, in one of my areas, particularly in Majhi community, I also identified that this kind of attachment and belongingness might also differ according to the age and sex as well, and gender as well. Because, you know, the younger generations, they wouldn't care as much as their elder generation, older generations would care about these issues. The female members in the family would be much more concerned about the spaces of the houses and things like that, design of the house and things like that, rather than the male members of the family. So this is what I can share about how, you know, these social cultural aspects of people and society are also equally important when we talk about recovery and reconstruction.
Well, thanks, Jeevanji. That's really, really interesting, the way you kind of describe the non-physical and sociocultural aspects of reconstruction. And we'll talk more about the Majhi community as part of the conversation. But in one of your other publications that we were reading, you also draw on your ethnographic work to talk about what you call flawed reconstruction. And I wonder if you could explain a little bit, what do you mean by flawed reconstruction, and what makes a reconstruction flawed? Can you share a little bit of your findings from that publication for our general audience?
Thank you, Nimeji, for that interesting question. In one of our articles, yes, we mentioned about the flawed reconstruction, but that, however, doesn't mean that we just wanted to valorize the limitation and the flaws that the recovery and reconstruction process that Nepal had. Obviously, you know, maybe all of us have noticed that Nepal had run sort of one of the largest reconstruction of the houses here in Nepal. Initially, I think the NRA had estimated about 800,000 houses to be rebuilt. I think the number has slightly increased after some of the grievances were redressed. So that's a huge task that was performed by Nepal government, the National Reconstruction Authority. On the positive side, I think we should also acknowledge the fact that Nepal's government institutions, research organizations, individuals, NGOs, civil society have also been able to learn a lot from the reconstruction and recovery process. I think some of the knowledge and understanding have been well captured. And then I would also argue that people's awareness about resilience, house, and safety has definitely increased because of the process. And we know for the fact that we have huge number of engineers, I think above 3,000 engineers, technicians, masons, and the workers who are involved in the reconstruction. Their capacity has definitely been enhanced. NRA, interestingly, has also been able to address almost 100% of the registered grievances, as it notes in its various publications, including its website, which is fantastic. But however, that there might be still some grievances, maybe that are not registered, or registered because of various reasons. So these are some of the things, among others, that we need to acknowledge. However, in that particular article, we were trying to talk about some of the limitations. NRA had adopted the policy of providing reconstruction grant of 300,000, which was, let's say, the one rate system, I would say. You know, everybody is entitled, every beneficiary or earthquake affected beneficiary, household was supposed to receive the 300,000 USD grant. However, as many of you know, that earthquake affected households had different characteristics. Not all of these houses were affected similarly, and they also did not have similar kind of capacities to recover and reconstruct their houses. If you think of the houses in the remote parts of the earthquake affected areas, where the cost of the reconstruction materials and the transportation for the same would be relatively much higher as compared to those who live adjacent to the roads facilities. And there are some poor households. There are maybe households without able member in the family. So these kind of one rate system of grant was not suitable. Another limitations and flaws was also in regards to how the assessment of these affected household was conducted. Recovery and reconstruction would be more evidence-based if the assessment had also captured some of the socioeconomic characteristics of the households. The government could come up with the understanding, proper understanding about different needs, different vulnerabilities of these households. One of the pertinent issue was the strict deadline, which was set for the founding, the foundation of the houses. You know, I think you remember that according to the Nepali calendar, it was end of Pus, which I think would be mid of January 2018, was set for the deadlines to lay their foundation in order for them to be eligible for the reconstruction houses. Because of that, you know, people had to rush for laying out the foundation. So what happened was that, you know, people did not have the flexibility to choose the house designs. They did not have any information, proper information about the building codes, and they had to rush to identify workers. They had to also rush for buying the construction materials at that time, and which was very, very difficult for them to manage. So at times even they were led to take loans with high interest rates because you know, they had thought about securing the second and third tranche of the grant. So that's how, you know, they were put in a more difficult situation. You know, I think it applies also in the context of the present crisis, but that time also, you know, these people did not have information about these building codes plans and things like that. So yeah, these strict deadlines restricted them to choose the construction materials which are available locally. They could have used, they would have chosen different kind of designs, but you know, they were forced to choose one room houses and two room houses that they ended up having. So that did not satisfy their needs about spaces that I mentioned earlier, spaces that they needed to store their food grains and other stuff. And you know, we have the culture of inviting our guests and accommodated them overnight, which I think the kind of spaces they had did not satisfy those needs. In one of my research areas, I also identified that people were not satisfied with the roof of the houses that they had, which was quite uninhabitable during the summer, which was because of the heat. And they were not also satisfied with the toilet and the drainage system that that was set up in the house, which they did not find good for their from the perspective of the hygiene as well. I think there are also there were also limitations in terms of the reconstruction loan. So there was this policy of providing subsidized loan to the earthquake affected households. In the rural area, it was rural area. It was 300,000, sorry, 3,000, without without any collateral, but collective collateral collateral that they would call. And in the urban and in Kathmandu area, there were also provisions for 15,000 USD and 25,000 USD. If you look at the number of people who have benefited out of these policies, it's nominal. It's because the government had had this policy to provide these loans through through financial institutions, but financial institutions were reluctant to provide these loans to the earthquake affected people, and the government would also not do anything to ensure that these people benefit from these loans. You know, they have to go through the bureaucratic hassles. The financial institution would not cooperate and collaborate with beneficiaries. You will notice if you visit these earthquake affected area that people have already started readjusting their houses. And the government of Nepal very funnily has also relaxed the policies to allow these people to readjust these houses. But I think one cannot be sure about the safety and resilience of the house which have been readjusted. People do not feel these new or house as their own house or own home. Rather, you know, you would find people calling even earthquake house or the government's house, rather than calling the newly built house as their home. So they would argue that they are yet to rebuild their house, or they would call it Hamro house in Nepal. So what I mean to say is that, you know, people who were affected were not consulted. Their needs were not prioritized. And then the policies and the plans were formulated and implemented without considering or without understanding the local context.
Thank you very much, Jeevanji. That's really insightful. And you highlighted the need to pay attention to these social aspects of disaster reconstruction. Earlier, you mentioned about your fascinating research on Majhi community in Sindupalchowk district and the effects of 2015 Nepal earthquake. What can we learn from this in-depth study of one specific community about the consequences of disasters more generally? What are the key lessons that are more generalizable?
Many aspects of the recovery and reconstruction are context-specific and very, very difficult to generalize. Nevertheless, I think perhaps there are some lessons that can be abstracted from the experience. For instance, I think, as I mentioned earlier, one of the important aspects would be the need for proper understanding about the local context and people's needs and priorities. The next would be to ensure the meaningful participation of the local people and the communities before we plan and execute, let's say, disaster risk reduction management plans and policies or recovery and reconstruction related plans. Another lessons that maybe that might be significant in most cases is, I would say, the effective and efficient political leadership and institutions, both at the in the present context, let's say, both at the federal as well as local level. Because even in the case of, you know, Dealing with the current COVID crisis, you would notice that the local governments and local institutions have been quite critical in order to deal with the situations. In the federal level also, if our institutions, let's say in the current context, the institution working on the pandemic and in the context of 2015 earthquake, let's say the institutions like NRA, Ministry of Local Development and General Administration, let's say the municipal governments, wards, these institutions would be quite instrumental. And I think that was evident in post 2050 earthquake as well, in which so far as I can recall, the reconstruction process had took off only after the local institutions, we had local institutions after 2017 earthquake, and many of the grievances that were related to, let's say, a reconstruction grant and reconstruction of the rural houses, that took off because after the local institutions were delegated with the authorities and mandates to facilitate this process. So it's very important that we have strengthened collaboration and cooperations among these government institutions. In addition to that, we need to engage people and communities in this process. It does two things. I think it provides some kind of sense of participation and ownership. At the same time, it also helps us to enhance, political accountability of these activities. And I think another very common lessons that we can say was the need for timely and clear and adequate information about policies, plan, and the kind of interventions that we have in these post-disaster and post-pandemic situations. If you provide adequate information and people have access to information in the language that they understand, we can do away with many of the harms in the society. I would suggest that the activities of various institutions like NGOs need to be effectively governed in order to ensure that people's vulnerabilities and situations are not further exacerbated or deteriorated because of the interventions.
Thanks so much, Jeevanji. And I think you mentioned about a very important point about how it is done, right? As a researcher, we also need to think about the actual practices and activities of reconstruction. And that's a very nice segue for my next question. You mentioned about the government-led reconstruction led by the National Reconstruction Authority, and also there are many community-led kind of reconstruction. But also there are a lot of NGOs, like humanitarian organizations, involved in reconstruction after the 2015 earthquake. And you've done research on that, looking at the more NGO-led reconstruction in the wake of the 2015 earthquake. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about, maybe there are areas of comparison or differences between the NGO-led and the government-led reconstruction, maybe. In areas of what you are talking about, making it more contextual, understanding local needs. Did you find any major differences or even similarities in the government-led versus NGO-led reconstruction?
Thank you, Nimeshi. I think you referred to one of the articles that I and my co-author Amrita Gurung wrote for the edited volume based on the SWAY project. I think in response to your questions, I think I can draw from that particular chapter as well as my experience from other research projects that I was involved in. I think we can think of some parallels in the process of, let's say, NGO-led reconstruction and government-led reconstruction. And there are also, I think, differences because their mandates, their roles and responsibilities, their capacities, their style of working would be different. So we can expect the variations in the experience as well. As you might be quite aware of, the NRA had developed an NGO mobilization policy, which permitted INGOs and NGOs to work in partnership with the NGOs and local community-based organizations in the recovery and reconstruction process. I think in some cases when NGOs were permitted to support, particularly what they would term the vulnerable groups, they have their own definition, whether that definition is encompassing or not is something that that is debatable. But the government had permitted NGOs to work in the designated area and for the designated groups, which they consider or defined vulnerable groups. In regards to the kind of reconstruction support that the NGOs provided, I think that some of the communities have definitely benefited from their interventions because they were able to build the houses on time that would provide shelter even during the first or second rainy season. Maybe some of the communities had better houses than what they previously had. And maybe in some cases, these people even did not have to care about, managing things to get their houses rebuilt. So people would be quite appreciative about these efforts. And some of the NGOs which were mobilized in the earthquake affected area maybe have also contributed to enhance the capacities of local institutions, missions, social mobilizers, and things like that, which we can consider to be quite positive in their part. However, in that article that you mentioned, we try to highlight, based on our study, that, despite the fact that we have this this policy of owner-driven reconstruction or building back better, we'd observe the contrasting experience in some of the areas that we studied. People, I think, again, as I referred earlier, people did not have clear understanding about the reconstruction of their houses, how it was going to be reconstructed, what kind of, design that they would have, what kind of financial arrangement that these institutions have, whether or to what extent the labor and expertise which were available locally would be utilized in the reconstruction process or not. I think in one of the areas, I should say the Majhi community, many of the families were even forced to be in the debt trap situation, because despite the fact the NGO pledged to rebuild their house and community, what they would call the model settlement, Namuna Basti, but my study found that their house reconstruction cost ranged between, including the interest. I'm accounting for the interest here. It has cost around $8,000 to $10,000 US dollar which is quite huge for them. And they've used the reconstruction grant provided by the government, but yet they're on loan. And they were quite distressed about the loan that they had to repay, and they were not in a situation to repay these loans. They shared with me that they are mentally disturbed. We have this this policy that we want to build back better, but you know they've been going through these experience. I think this is not the case across all the model resettlements. But in my area, I identified that this is the case. I also identified that these peoples did not realize that they had to take loans and they will have to repay the loans. Despite the fact that some of these NGOs would consult with some of the, let's say, the leaders in the community or Agua in the community, the consultation was very limited between these two groups. So the households and the members were rarely consulted. Even if they were consulted for some purposes. So people were not happy about the house that they were having. In one of the maybe cases that that I would also I would mention here that, you know, the kind of program and the plans that NGOs had brought into these communities were not matching with the priorities and the needs of the people. Let me give you an example of one NGO that that came to the community and told the local organization to lay the coffee beds, you know, because they that program had been designed in Kathmandu, the local organizations were supposed to show the evidence that fund that was provided for the coffee production had to be turned in. And then it was the rainy season in which they were asked to lay out the foundation, but people would find that that was not the appropriate time to for the the coffee bed. So, you know, people have different needs and different priorities, but NGOs developed these plans and the programs here in Kathmandu that did not suit the time need of the people. And in one of the cases, we also identified that the NGOs that would come up with the relief and recovery programs would rather than working with the pre-existing community organization and local institution, they would feel more comfortable forming new organizations to work with. So many of the pre-existing institutions would also share that their already weakened capacities were further set aside and they were ignored. I had that evidence as well, and in some of the cases, these NGOs would also prefer to work in the areas that were accessible. But not in the remote areas. Local institution and in some cases, there are also instances of nepotism and favoritism in order to allocate some of these programs. Let's say the providing mission trainings, and the people would benefit, would get certain wages, and then at the same time they would take advantage of the skill training that were provided. But the local elites and these NGO people would have their own preference to select the participants in these training activities. So people have negative attitudes and perceptions towards NGOs. And in one of the cases, let me, I was reminded now, but I, in one of the cases, you know, it was quite quite contradictory that, you know, one of the NGOs pushed the people to push or force to rebuild their the houses, you know, because they had to meet the certain deadlines. The NGOs had their own deadlines, you know, from the donors. So the NGO people would want people to start restart the house. The people would say that we were under distress because we wouldn't be able to do that. And at the same time, very, very funnily and contrastingly, these same organizations were also providing the psychosocial counseling to the people which were affected by the earthquake, you know. On the other hand, they were injecting the distresses and stresses in these people, but at the same time, you know, they were providing these psychosocial trainings.
Yeah, we're now coming to the end of our conversation, Jeevanji. Before we conclude, we'd like to hear your thoughts on the ongoing COVID crisis. Are there any lessons that we can learn from the 2015 Nepal earthquake that can be applied in response to the COVID-19? Or are there any lessons that should be avoided?
Thank you, Majhi. That's a very difficult question, I would say. One of the things that I can think of would be, you know, we still have lack of proper understanding about the disasters. I think we need more, or we need to improve our understanding and knowledge about disasters and what kind of factors that shape risk and vulnerabilities. Perhaps before before the disaster, pandemic, or crisis hit us, I think we can do some kind of scenario mapping in which we can map geohazards, political landscape, socioeconomic aspects, you know, things like that. That might shape risk, and we can also think about, you know, the factors that can help us mitigate the risks and vulnerabilities in this context. I think you've already noticed that we have this heartening scene about new grave situations that our vulnerable people, for example, the wage workers, poor people, migrant workers, had to go through in the situation of COVID-19. Maybe we would have thought about these peoples, you know, in advance, in order to come up with the proper response and support. So that's, I think, one thing that I can relate to, I think. I think we also need to again think about how we can ensure and internalize the voices of the people, their needs and priorities in our plans and implementation. I think in both case of recovery and reconstruction, as well as dealing with the current unprecedented situation of COVID-19, we have to think and prioritize indigenous response rather than the external and always from the top. Obviously, we need some collaboration and coordination between different institutions at various level of governance, but we need to think about the indigenous response and local knowledge and skills. The next, I would say that in the both cases, I think the issue of political accountability and transparency, or what we can maybe call the democracy and governance participations, these are quite important aspects in order to prepare ourselves and to better respond to these natural events and other kind of events. As you know that Nepal's political situation and the system of governance right now stands as a conundrum. However, I think we need to focus on strengthening the collaboration and cooperation between the institutions that are working on the sector of DRRM and crises. And the pandemic situations like that. Specifically in the current context, I think the institutions working in this area in provincial and local level do not have enough capacity. So it's very, very crucial that we think about strengthening their capacity as well. Both in the context of the COVID-19 and post 2015 earthquake, I think one of the issues that became quite evident was, I think the lack of accountability in the part of the donors. You know, we don't know when we are going to get the vaccine in this context. I think donors and international community could also and should also play quite important role. I remember that in the International Conference on Nepal's Reconstruction, many donor countries and donor organizations had placed the grant to the Nepal government in order to facilitate recovery and reconstruction in Nepal. However, many of these institutions were either delayed in order to disburse the fund that they had placed, or they were even reluctant for a long time to provide the reconstruction grant. If you just look at the record about the donors that they had placed support in the conference, and the actual amount and the timeline they provided the fund to the NRA and the Nepal government, you can understand discrepancies that we had. I think even in the context of vaccine, the similar kind of experience can be quite important.
Thank you very much, Jeevanji. Really appreciate your time.
Thank you. It was fascinating, Jeevanji.
Thank you. Thank you very much for both of you for this interesting initiatives.